So again, it's my real privilege to introduce somebody that I've been a gigantic fan of for a very, very long time, Peter Schwartz. Peter is the senior strategy person at Salesforce, senior VP at Salesforce.com. Prior to that, he was the chairman of the Global Business Network, which was owned by the Monitor Group, and he was a partner at Monitor Group. Before that, Peter was the head of scenario planning at Royal Dutch Petroleum, which is famous for their scenario planning. Peter's a member of the Council of Foreign Relations, the World Affairs Council in Singapore, the Innovation Enterprise Council. He also sits on the boards of the Long Now Foundation, the Center for New American Security, and the Strategic Studies Center for Strategic Studies in Singapore. Again, I don't think there is a more prominent or serious thinker about the future and what it could look like than Peter Schwartz. Again, an accomplished author, accomplished strategist, and a remarkable thinker. So with that, Peter, the stage is yours. Thank you.
The clicker. Did you take the clicker? Thank you for your kind introduction, but I need the clicker. I do appreciate your kind introduction, and it's an honor to share the stage with Governor Romer. Like many of you, I'm an admirer. Colorado has had a very good run of governors. Dick Lamb was a good friend, your predecessor, and a number of your successors. This seems to be a state that chooses its leaders wisely, so thank you. What I'm going to talk about today is technology, jobs, and education. The profound technological changes that we're going through right now, how that's going to change the world of work and the world of business, the world of organizations, and what does that imply about education. Now let me say, I'm not an educator. I'm a little bit out of my turf there. I've given a fair amount of thought to it for this talk, but you know very much more, but I'll try to bring something that you may not have seen yet in terms of education. I must say, GSV sent me your amazing book on Education 2020. Profound. I assume all of you have seen it. If you haven't, it's thick. It's a read. 450 pages, I think, something like that. But it's worth it. Beautifully presented, quite original, and I learned a lot. So thank you for it. I'm not going to talk today at all about Salesforce. There'll be a couple allusions to it. This is not about selling you Salesforce, but it is about what we're thinking. But I have to do this. This is our legal statement that nothing I'm going to talk about today is anything I'm going to sell you. You can buy today. Thank you. Okay. The title of my talk is "The Technology Awakens the World." And I use that because we are about to go through a really rather profound change in technology. That is, that what we're seeing is a remarkable convergence of multiple technologies, and every human-created artifact around us is about to come alive. It will have embedded sensors, intelligence, and it will speak to us. It will be our rooms, our tables, our appliances, our chairs, our cars. Everything around us is about to come alive. And over the next decade, what we're going to be living in is a human-created artifact that is, in fact, like a great mind. And so the world is actually waking up. The natural world is already awake. The human-created world is awakening right now. And it is the result of the convergence of a number of technologies. I'm the oldest guy in Salesforce. And I love the irony, the oldest guy's in charge of the future. Shortest future, I've got to think about it. I take it seriously. I just turned 70 a few weeks ago. And in Silicon Valley, that makes me really ancient. I am by far the oldest person in the company. But I've lived through all of these things. And we've gone through a number of major discontinuities that many of us have experienced. One or two of you in the room, like me, have experienced the whole gamut here. But each of us probably have experienced at least some of these. You know, I was born in a world without computers. In fact, my father worked on one of the very first computers at Princeton. He was a technician at RCA and delivering components to Norbert Wiener and building the first computers. And I remember learning programming as a kid from my father. When I went to college at RPI and got my degree in astronautical engineering, I'm actually a rocket scientist. It's the only virtue of my degree, I get to say that. My first computer was an IBM System 360, and computers began to take off. It was a computer about half the size of this room, programmed in Fortran. And the world actually began to understand what computers meant. We went through a major technological change, but it wasn't in the hands of everybody yet. And then came the personal computer in the 1980s. And that was the revolution that probably many of us in this room began to experience, when you had computing power in your own hands. And that was a huge change. But the one that really has made a huge difference, and it's the one that Mike referred to in a moment, is this. This is the personal computer for everybody. This is Steve Jobs' most important invention, and I'm going to come back to it. This was a major discontinuity for humans all over the world. Well, we're about to go through another one. What we're seeing now is the convergence of multiple technologies. And when you see these convergences, what you see are huge discontinuities. What we're seeing is big data coming together, new forms of analytics, new forms of visualization. We're beginning to connect everything in the Internet of Things. We're embedding those with intelligence. And now that intelligence is built on machine learning and getting better and better and better and faster. So all of that is converging together to create a major technological discontinuity that is unfolding right now and will be spreading very rapidly throughout the world over the next 5 to 10 years. So it's this discontinuity that I'm going to talk about, and what does all that mean? So when you think about the future, Mike mentioned I do something called scenario planning. And it's about thinking about an uncertain future. How do you understand and make better decisions? It's not about making better predictions. It's about making better decisions in the face of uncertainty. So on the right there, you see an example of why you need it. Basically, in 1980, AT&T invented the cell phone. They figured out how to build cell phones. In those days, there were portable phones. They were called car phones. They sat on the dash of, right? If you were an executive or a general or an admiral, you had a car phone. Or maybe a governor. Maybe you had a car phone, Governor Romer. But nobody had portable telephones. There was no such thing as a cell phone. So AT&T commissioned McKinsey to do a forecast. What was the demand for portable telephony by, say, 2020, by 2000, pardon me? And they said, oh, you could sell maybe about 900,000 of them. And they said, yeah, not really worth it. So they licensed the technology to somebody else called Motorola. And as they say, the rest was history. And of course, the right answer was about 100 million. Now, was McKinsey stupid? No, they weren't. These are some of the smartest guys around. But what they were doing was projecting on the basis of the past. If you really want to understand major discontinuities, you have to use a bit of imagination along with rigor. So they might have come up with multiple scenarios. One scenario is, it's just like the past, 900,000. But suppose everybody gets a phone. Why, then it might be 100 million. But it could have also been, suppose that cell phones actually did fry your brain like some people thought. Well, it might have been zero. So you might have had three scenarios, zero, 1 million, or 100 million. You know, that's how you begin to think about uncertainty. So you like try to imagine different possibilities. Well, if you think about the kind of technologies we're talking about here, there's still some big uncertainties that will affect how rapidly things move ahead. All the problems of data. That is, we're gathering lots of data, but we don't know how to use the data very well. We don't know how to integrate it. It's a huge challenge for us in Salesforce. What's the user experience? You know, how easy is this to use? I don't know how many of you have had the frustrating experience of trying to log into a website and try and get the things registered, and it doesn't work, and it's a miserable experience, right? I mean, that was one of the beauties of Amazon and Facebook. They made the user experience really easy. You think about intelligence. Well, we're all very excited about AI, and I'm going to talk a fair amount about that. But question, how easy will it be to use? Will it be like any other information commodity? Will it be democratically available? So there's a lot of uncertainties yet in thinking about these technologies, and I'm going to be addressing them as I go along. Now, as I said, the most important technology today is the smartphone. And the reason is, of course, it's not a phone. You obviously all use it for many, many more things than a telephone. And today you can buy one of these in Jakarta for about $40. And within a few years, today there are about 2 billion of these in the planet. In about 5 years, there will be 5 billion on the planet. And within 10 years, everyone on the planet will have a device that will be equivalent of this. And this device will stay fairly similar for the next 5 years, the black slab of glass like this. But it'll also take other forms. There'll be flexible ones that you can put on your body, keyboards that you can wrap, ones that you can even, the equivalent of tattoos. So we're going to come up with a variety of devices to connect with this. But what it really is a platform for services. How many of you are wearing something like a Fitbit? Right? It's already had a huge impact. Lots of people wearing some kind of health monitor. I use my Apple Watch that way. My wife is a serious exercise person. And of course, with the iPhone, she competes with all her friends, right? They all, post how you get your 10,000 steps today. And if she hasn't hit her 10,000 steps, it's 10 o'clock at night, we're watching The Daily Show, and she's in the bedroom in a robe getting her last 10,000 steps in, making sure. Because if her friends see she didn't get her 10,000 in, they're going to give her all kinds of stuff the next day. Well, she just had her physical about 2 weeks ago, and her doctor said, I want to see your Fitbit results. In fact, I want to be listed on your iPhone to actually get your results. And so what's about to happen is your doctor, your healthcare provider, is going to make it not an option, but a necessity for you to wear a health monitor of some sort, whether it's a Fitbit or a smartphone or whatever it is that you're using. They're going to want to see, how's your diet? How's your exercise? How's your sleep? How's your weight? How are you doing? And it won't be an option. Soon it will be a necessity, and we'll all be wearing health monitors. And the impact on health, et cetera, is likely to be actually rather profound. That little square with an A, that's a Fitbit for a car. It's called an automatic. You can plug it in a port in your car and get all the data that the company and the mechanic gets off your car. And if you're a car person, well, that's kind of fun. But of course, who else wants it? It's your insurance company. They want to know how your car is. They want to know, is it being maintained properly? How are you driving? Are you driving too fast, et cetera? So that's going to happen up there. The little circle up to your right, that's a Nest home thermostat, right? Also will be controlled from this device. It'll also open your front door, it'll control your lights, it'll control all kinds of things around the house. But who else will want that information? Is your home insurance company. How's your fire alarm working? Is your home properly maintained, etc.? Are you home a lot? Are you traveling away a lot? Is your house turned off, etc.? So what we are moving into is a world of universal monitoring. And this will be the platform for it. All the data will run through here. You will share data with others. You will monitor a great variety of situations, including the classroom, including work, including travel, etc. So it's a world of universal monitoring. And the truth is, we're actually going to get a lot of value out of it. People are going to talk about, oh, is it worth giving up the privacy for that? Well, you're sharing information voluntarily with a service provider, your doctor, your auto insurance company, etc., that you make a choice. Now, the choice is going to be a matter of necessity in many instances. You won't get the service without it. But that's going to be the situation. So we're going to find ourselves in a world very soon where this is a universal device and a platform for all kinds of services. Now, to do that, of course, we need to have access everywhere. This depends upon access to the cloud. That's where all that data lives. That's where all that data is mostly processed today. And what we're now seeing is a great variety of innovative solutions to the problem of access in remote locations. It's easy enough to get access in cities, but that little solar-powered drone there was just flown by Facebook. It can stay up in a circle in an area of about 300 square miles, orbiting at about 80,000 feet, and provide internet access over that whole area. Experiments with balloons, microsatellites, even new light-based technologies. But the point is that we're headed to this world of 6 billion smartphones, 7 billion connected people, 75 billion connected devices in the next 4 years. 75 billion connected devices in the next 4 years. That's the pace, and they're all going to be operating in this dense information network worldwide. Now, the other thing that's also happening is that the interfaces that we use to interact with it are also moving. So one of the ones that I think is very important and going to be very important for education is augmented reality. And by that, what we mean is information in the field of vision. So I think Google Glass was the first of those. And many of you may have tried it. It was kind of funky, right? You kind of had to squint like this. And push. Well, Google is coming out with a new version next year. In fact, we're working with them. You'll be able to get Salesforce on your Google Glass. It's actually much more important than that. What we're moving toward is a world, next year you're going to start seeing over the next 3 to 5 years, actually, a great variety of products, various forms of glasses at first, that present information in the field of vision. Now, there are many obvious examples in, say, field service, trying to fix things that are complicated and so on, where you want information. But think about it in the laboratory. Think about it in medical education. I had surgery recently. I had my hip replaced, and my doctor, it was at Stanford University Hospital. My doc is a teaching doc. He asked me, would you mind if my students watch the surgery? And I said, no, but imagine if they could have looked through his eyes instead. And he was explaining what he was doing. And he had the x-rays that he needed up in his field of vision. And he was able to engage with that information in that as he needed it. He didn't have to turn away and look at things and so on. He was actually able to focus on the patient at the same moment. So augmented reality, and the current basic state of the art is the Microsoft HoloLens. It's probably the best of them. And you can try that in a variety of places, the Microsoft stores. But it's worth starting to experiment with the technology because I think it's going to be very, very significant. I'm going to come back to virtual reality a little later, which I think will be important, but a bit later. The next is haptic and tactile. What that means is essentially information that comes from the sense of touch, right? So you feel roughness with tactile senses and smoothness and so on. Well, the gentleman there is a guy named David Eagleman. And David is a neurobiologist who just left Baylor University to come to Stanford make a startup in communication for the blind and the deaf. He's wearing a vest. His particular specialty in neurobiology is synesthesia, the transposition of senses when you hear colors and you see sound and so on. And there are people who have this as a disorder. But it turns out you can actually teach people to actually hear visually and see sound. And the way you do that is with this vest. And essentially, over a course of several months, using either an audio sensor or an optical sensor, you can train a blind person or a deaf person to transform that visual information or that audio information into physical sense of touch and actually be able to see and hear in the tactile spectrum, not the audio or the video spectrum. So the startup just coming out, now you start thinking about education for the handicapped, right, for the blind and the deaf. And suddenly you can see a whole new world beginning to open up. So this is just beginning, but in fact, the science is well understood, and it's only a matter of actually developing the, well, the product already exists. The question is actually getting out in large scale and demonstrating that it works on a large scale. The one on the right, however, is the most radical. And the most radical is actually brain control. Excuse me, could I have a glass of water, please? Today, what we're going through is something quite significant in terms of the ability of the brain to control external devices. And sadly, what's driving it is the need for new prosthetics. Thank you, Mike. As a result of the several wars that we have been involved in over the last decade and a half, what has happened is that many young soldiers have come home minus limbs. And as a result, the military has invested a great deal in developing neural control for prosthetic limbs. And what we are now seeing is the first wave of those actually beginning to hit, i.e. people who control arms, hands, legs, and so on by thinking. In fact, the most advanced is a scientist at MIT, Hugh Herr. And Hugh is at the Media Lab. And Hugh had a climbing accident, actually, when he was a teenager, went on to become a biophysicist because he lost the lower half of both of his legs. And so he has built the most advanced prosthetic legs that he controls from his brain. And in fact, he has multiple different legs. He has running legs, walking legs, dancing legs. He has legs for going out at night. They're all chrome. They're straight out of Star Wars. They're totally cool looking. He likes to say that the upper half of his body is deteriorating at the same rate as the rest of us, and the lower half is improving on a 3-month innovation cycle, right? But again, that's not so distant, i.e. the idea that we can control devices, first our own limbs, but you think about controlling external devices. So that lady is controlling a computer screen, right? Controlling machines, controlling vehicles, controlling a cursor on a screen. If I can control a cursor on a screen, I can create a message. I can think and the message appears. If you can have it read there, you can read it in. Network-enabled telepathy, i.e. the ability to think and have another person read that thought. Now, that's going to take a while, call it 10, 15 years. But we're also at the first stage where we'll actually be able to think and control a car, an airplane, a machine tool, a creative device of all sorts. And the implications of that, obviously, for education, you're going to have to teach people how to literally think and control devices. It will become a new skill that will be just simply the normal skill of how you live in a modern world, the ability to think and control machines. Now, that's a bit further off, but augmented reality is here now. Haptic and tactile are just coming. So what we're seeing then in this world of everything coming alive is every environment in which we live will be connected, have sensors and intelligence. We'll have the connected home, right? Every device at home. How many of you have something like an Amazon Echo at home already? I love it. I don't know about you, but I have two of them, Alexa, and I'm now getting the various things. And, you know, it's my wife is an Audible junkie also, right? So we just found out that Alexa can read to us, right? We're reading an amazing, well, we're listening to an amazing book by a guy named Larry Brilliant. It's called Brilliant, worth reading, worth listening, whichever you prefer. But our home is reading to us. That's what's happening. This is part of our home environment. So what we're seeing is that the home, every device, every moment at home will actually be in a living thing that we will design and create ourselves. We obviously are going to have the connected person. I've already talked about the medical devices and so on. But the connected car is a really big deal, right? Because, of course, we're now starting to get more information on the screens of our cars. And, of course, we're beginning to move toward the self-driving car. And in fact, I want to pick up on something you said, Mike. We are beginning to see the end of the era of the private car. The numbers you showed of the elderly versus the young car buyer is actually very significant. Young people don't care about cars anymore, right? I grew up as a car guy, right? You know, a buddy of mine and I actually built our first car. We bought an old burned out MGA and built it. It was what you did when you were a guy in the 50s and 60s. You were a car guy, you know, and you could fix carburetors and you could change the spark plugs. You could change the oil. I even once did a clutch. I remember I felt so accomplished, right? Recently, I went to look under the hood of my car, a Z4, to check the oil, and I couldn't find the dipstick. So I called the dealer and I said, hey, I must be an idiot. I can't find the dipstick. And says, yes, you are an idiot. There is no dipstick. We don't want you to touch anything, right? It's a big block of aluminum. Do not touch it. And kids today don't grow up with cars. They don't grow up. My son couldn't care less about a car, right? He wants to know when's the next iPhone coming. He doesn't want to know when's the next Mac coming, not when's the next Mustang coming. He could care less. And so what is actually happening is that the age at which people get their first license is also rising. And the car as an artifact of our civilization, which it really was, is beginning to fade. And you think about the fact in 1890, there were 16 million working horses in America. By 1910, it was 3 million. And, you know, they used to haul everything by horse. And then it became trucks and cars. Well, we're going that way with the automobile. I assume none of you take a horse to work. Is that right? Right. Yeah. Well, maybe here in Colorado, there might be one or two of you, but most of us don't take horses to work, right? We take cars. Well, the same thing is about to happen to your car. That is that over the next 20 years or so, we're going to have less and less cars in the city, less and less people driving cars to work, less and less people driving work cars to the doctor or shopping, etc. We'll call up the car. It'll come pick us up, etc. Now, the few of us who are car junkies may still keep our sports cars or our SUVs for going out in the country and driving out there, just like people today ride horses, etc., for that purpose and have fun riding their horses. I probably will still drive a sports car when I'm 80. But nevertheless, when I want to go to work, I won't take that car. And so what we're seeing is the end, the beginning of the end of the private automobile. And it's a huge transformation. It'll happen worldwide, just not in the United States. In fact, as was mentioned, I do a lot of work in Singapore, going there Friday night, as a matter of fact. I'm on the energy board and the R&D board of the country. Last January, we made a decision to start experimenting with self-driving cars, and in September, they announced the first large-scale experiment of a taxi fleet of self-driving cars, already up and running. We went from decision in January to implementation in September. That's the way Singapore works. But having said that, this is as huge a transformation as you can imagine. The connected workplace, everything in the workplace is going to be connected, the walls, the desks, every environment. And of course, everywhere you go, there's going to be connectivity in the city. Every building, every street corner, it will have essentially connectivity. So everywhere you go, essentially, you will have sensors, intelligence, and connectivity to enable a great variety of services. So imagine what a day in the life might be like. Okay, so there's my Amazon Echo. And I had a rough night last night, so, you know, I told my Alexa, you know, wake me up soft in the morning, you know, no hard alarms, no Rolling Stones. So Alexa goes, Peter, time to wake up. You know, nice, gentle wake up. And then it knows already, because it's been around for a while. It knows what I need to know in the morning. It tells me what my first appointments are, when I need to be at the office, what the most important news is, has my wife gone in the newspaper yet, et cetera, all those kinds of things, all the important knowledge I need at that moment. So it is in that environment there at home. As it happens, I'm not going to the office first. I'm going to go to a meeting with some colleagues, call up the car to come pick us up. A car arrives, and we're on our way to that meeting with my colleagues. And, of course, we want to rearrange the slide, so I talk to my car, which is the same as my Alexa. My assistant has moved from the home and into my car. And I say, Alexa, you know, bring up the slides that we're going to use in the meeting. I want to show them and shows them, and I want to change the order. And my colleagues and I are doing that in the car because the car is actually a working environment. None of us is driving. The car is taking us. It's like a mobile office, if you will. And my assistant is living with me in the car. Of course, I get to the office after the meeting, and, of course, my assistant has moved into the walls of my office. So I say, Alexa, you know, I want to change my appointments this afternoon. Do me a favor, change the 3 o'clock to a 2 o'clock, and move the slides from the 3 o'clock also to the 2 o'clock meeting. And, oh, by the way, Alexa, I want to arrange a flight tomorrow to Munich. And you know the hotel I stayed in 2 weeks ago? Well, get that same hotel. And the driver we used the last time, he was no good. So get a different driver. And so, well, Alexa will be able to understand all of that, will know my preferences, understand it, will be an assistant in every possible way. So it will be interacting in my environment with me all the time. End of the day, I want to get some exercise, decide I'm going to go for a run, as I regularly do. I often run with a friend, but he's out of town, so I call up the ghost image of my friend. It alerts him that I'm going for a run with him. You can see my friend there running alongside me in my augmented reality glasses, which I'm wearing, giving me data all the time on what I'm doing, where I'm going, information about my environment. Oh, there's a detour that just started some construction 3 blocks ahead. Why don't you go around the block that way? It's also telling me what's going on with my friend, and my friend is communicating. You're never going to beat my time with that kind of speed. And so that's what the running experience is like in that augmented environment where Alexa's alongside me, urging me along, giving me the data that I need. I get home, and, you know, some people like to watch TV at night. I'm a kind of learner. I like to learn things. And as it happens, I'm on the board of a cancer research company studying breast cancer, but I graduated from college in 68. Nothing worth knowing in biology was known then. I mean, we knew there was DNA, and that was about it. And so my deal with the CEO of the company is that before every board meeting, he has to teach me molecular biology so I understand what's going on. So I call up Cyrus and says, oh, Cyrus, we've got a board meeting tomorrow. I'm ready for another lesson. So I said, why don't we go into shared virtual reality? We both put on our virtual reality helmets. He's at his at the lab. I'm at home. And into VR we go to study how the molecules are evolving. So there he is in VR being able to show me how this molecule connects with this kind of tumor. This molecule does not because the receptors aren't here. And he shows me how the structure of the molecules actually unfold. In shared virtual reality, it is the internet of experience. It's the world we share together for a common educational experience in VR. In fact, I think the most interesting element of virtual reality is shared virtual reality, the internet of experience, as Kevin Kelly talked about it. By the way, if you haven't read Kevin's new book, I highly recommend it. It's called The Inevitable by Kevin Kelly. And all of this you'll find in Kevin's book as well. But that's what a day in the life looks like when everything around us is alive, when all the technology is talking to us, knows our preferences, knows what we want, and is able to provide the services anytime, anywhere. So, you think about, I'm going to skip this one in the interest of time. Where the big issue, as I mentioned earlier, was data. And today what we find is that 97% of the data that's being generated is useless. About 1% is actually useful. I saw a picture from the gentleman from Ingram, the piles of textbooks, right? Imagine if we tried to digitize all of that and tried to actually capture all of that. We wouldn't know how to make it all work. We just can't make the stuff talk to each other yet. Now, some of us were around in the 1980s when you could not send a file from a Macintosh to a Windows machine and vice versa, right? Then came software that connected them. There was something called TOPS that allowed you to convert files from one to the other. But eventually, the internet protocols came along, HTTP and TCP/IP, that enabled us to move information easily between systems. And that's what we need to have happen now. And it doesn't exist yet. There's a lot of work going on how we can create the next generation of protocols that allow the data from one device to communicate with another device. And that's going to be the thing that actually determines how quickly all this technology actually plays out. This is the hardest part, because this is actually what requires universal agreements and standards that do not yet exist. So things will happen a bit more slowly than many of us would like to have happen, and this is why. Now, as I said earlier, we're going to have these kinds of digital devices, and these are all the forms of personal assistance that have been put out there. And it's the move from personal computing to intimate computing. Personal computing is when you know your computer. Intimate computing is when it knows you. And what's going to happen, again, is that all that information about you is going to be used to generate a very rich picture of what you want and what you need anywhere, anytime. So these are all the different devices. There's the Amazon Echo, Siri, Cortana, Facebook's M, etc. All those. The latest one is Viv. And this is actually very, very important. This, every single person will have a personal assistant before too long. I have four people whose job it is to make me look smart, right? All these slides, they did all of this. How many of you have an executive assistant? How many of you don't? Right, most of you don't. So the CEOs in the room do. All the rest of you actually have to work. Right? All of us at the top of organizations have people who help us get our work done and make us much more productive. Everybody else actually has to work and get all their own work done. Well, soon everyone will have a personal assistant. Everyone. At the home, the office, at school, everywhere. And those personal assistants will be gathering information, organizing that information in useful ways for people anywhere, anytime. And so what we're going to see is a dramatic improvement in service productivity. If you look at history, what we've seen is an enormous investment in technology for manufacturing, the assembly line, machine tools, all that sort of thing, but not in services. In services, we got offices and laptops. That's basically what we got. We have not reorganized work fundamentally. We have not transformed that work by the nature of the technology itself. And that's where we're about to go in the service economy. And it's very significant in a macro sense because 70% of workers today in most of the industrialized world are in services and not manufacturing. And one of the reasons for the productivity slowdown and the slow growth is low growth in service sector productivity. This is how we're going to improve service sector productivity, improve the productivity of every single service sector worker. And so we're going to see a dramatic transformation of how work gets done as everyone has that personal assistant that organizes life for them, just as I described a moment ago. However, there's a big wrinkle in the story, and that is the ecosystems. Today, if you want to start to play, you have to make a choice. Do you want to play in the Apple ecosystem, the Amazon ecosystem, the Facebook ecosystem, the Google ecosystem? Because they all do not connect, right? So here's the Apple ecosystem. You have Apple devices, you have Apple Pay, you have CarPlay, you have HomeKit, you have iBeacon, and you have Apple TV, all nicely integrated. Until, of course, you want to go to Amazon. And that's the problem. And so for the near future, it's going to be a difficult set of choices. Do you live in the Amazon system or in the Apple system or the Google system? Eventually, we'll figure out how to make all these things talk to each other and you can make choices. But for the near future, it's going to be an awkward set of choices. How do you play in the face of substantial variation among the systems that do not connect to each other? Now, a new idea that's come along, and I'm going to use this a bit later to show you how it might be used in education, is the idea of blockchain. And blockchain is a form of distributed ledger. And it may be a way of actually achieving new forms of both disintermediation and trust, i.e., Blockchain, well, first of all, how many of you know what blockchain or have heard what blockchain is? I don't know how much explaining I have to. So let me explain a little bit. Blockchain is a mathematical form that allows the simultaneous updating of everybody who has that particular chain operating. So it's a perfect form of essentially disintermediating, getting between systems, as well as achieving perfect security and trust among a highly distributed set of information content holders. And so we've already seen things like digital currency, Bitcoin. I myself think Bitcoin is probably not going to make it, but because it was a little premature, but we will have some form of digital currency. But it could be done smart contracts. You can do a great variety of securities applications. So today, if you settle a securities trade, it's a fairly complex process involving information going to one place, operations taking place, information going back out again, and so on. And it, actually, settlement often takes 24 hours, but it should be instantaneous. Blockchain is a way of doing secure, instantaneous settlement of securities, for example. Secure healthcare records, universally available. Title records, intellectual property. So there's a great variety of potential applications. And later on, I'm going to show you a little video of how blockchain might actually be used in education. But there's something big here, and it's early stages. And, you know, it's very hard to know exactly how it will play out, but I'm pretty sure that it's going to be significant. So it's a technology at least worth tracking. Now, I said I'm going to focus very heavily on AI, and that's where I'm turning now. And what we've seen is, if you think about how we use our data, most of data we have is about hindsight, what has already happened, right? So we know what's happened, and we drive into the future with essentially a rear view mirror only, no windscreen at all. Well, today we're getting better at getting real-time data, understanding what's going on. That's what's happening with diagnostic analytics and so on. But where we're going, the next move is prediction. And that's where the machine learning and the AI is actually getting very significant. We're going to be able to predict the next move of any technology. And then prescription. What should we do about the prescription, the prediction? Is this machine about to break? Should we fix it? Here's how we should fix it, and so on. So what we've got is the movement from the past into the future and prescriptive action. That list of companies there are companies that we've bought over the last year or so. We buy about a company a month. All of those are artificial intelligence companies that we have integrated into a platform we call Einstein. And I won't say any more about that, but that's our newest product offering. Now, the reason I say that there's a big revolution going on here is this chart. Now, you can't read all those names, but those hundreds of names up there are startups in machine intelligence. Literally hundreds. We have investments in about 90 of them ourselves. As I said, we acquire about one a month. And when I look at the future of technology, I look at three T's: tools, talent, and treasure. Is there some fundamental new tools available? Well, machine learning is, in fact, the fundamental new set of tools. Where's the talent going? Well, every smart kid from Carnegie Mellon, MIT, or Stanford's going to one of these startups. And where's the treasure going? Well, where are you investing? You're investing in companies like this, machine intelligence. This is where the venture capital is going. So tools, talent, and treasure, all going into machine intelligence. And so what you see, a lot of these companies are going to fail. Some will be acquired, and there's one or two future giants in there. The next IBM may be in there. The next HP may be in there, and so on. And so what we're seeing is a very broad, multifaceted revolution in machine intelligence that will find its manifestation in many, many, many different applications. And it won't be just for the few. What we're seeing is already the democratization of the AI platform. Essentially, intelligence as a service. And so you already have Microsoft Azure, IBM Watson, OpenAI, Amazon Web Services, and so on. So anybody can today go out and essentially buy artificial intelligence services, develop an application, provide the data, and use those services off of commonly available platforms. So we're already moving to that environment where intelligence exists as a service that we can acquire anytime, anywhere. Now, an important question is when you start thinking, now we're beginning to make the transition between technology, artificial intelligence, and human beings, right? So the question is, are there unique skills that human beings have that actually make them distinct from machines? Well, one of those, obviously, is judgment. So question, what about human judgment? Well, the way I see it is it's actually about augmentation and a combination of human and machine intelligence, not the replacement of one for the other. Now, we already have Pandora as a disc jockey, but the ones I like are the ones you may not have heard of over there. Everybody knows Pandora. Blue River. That device you see there is a lettuce bot. Yeah, a lettuce bot. That's called a lettuce bot. And it's hauled behind a tractor, and it is an intelligent sensor and recommendation device for the farmer. On board are sensors at the literally 1 centimeter square level of resolution. They're reading the condition of the soil, water, fertilizer, pesticides, etc., reading the state of the plants, the location of the plants, and on the farmer's tractor is a screen. And it's constantly making recommendations to them. The AI say, you know, you should pull these plants or two close together. You should put in some fertilizer over here, add water over here. Don't put any more pesticide over there, etc. In other words, it's a smart assistant to the farmer, not replace the farmer, but improving his yield. It is, in fact, the tool you need for precision agriculture. And we're already beginning to see these kinds of devices beginning to move into the field. The next right, that's automated insights. If you read the sports section of some local papers, you may find games described, say the Davenport, Iowa Hawkeye baseball team, not covered by the New York Times. Well, the report of that game was probably written by an AI. And because the score is a fairly standard sort of statement. So-and-so hit made three hits, the pitcher made seven strikeouts, and the score was 7-2 at the end of the game. Right? That's the report of the game. If you read the Wall Street Journal, you see those little reports of company reports where they've done the results. Almost all of those today are written by an AI already, right? Because they're fairly standard statements. You know, company X issued its results yesterday, sales were up, profits were down, they fired the CEO. Boom, that's the report. In the Wall Street Journal. So what we already have are the ability to write fairly common statements of that sort using intelligence, and we're beginning to get that. But the one I really love is analytic. And analytic is in the business of medical diagnosis. Some of you are getting on like I am, and when you get to be my age, one of the things that happens is nasty little things grow on your body, and you have to have them nipped off to see if there's something really wrong with you. So if you look carefully, you'll see a little notch in my left ear over here. That's one of those. So you get that snipped off. The doctor sends it off to a laboratory, and about 10 days later, you find out if you're going to die. And in that interim, you're sitting there waiting, oh my God, do I have melanoma or not? High anxiety. Well, what's happening? Well, what's happening is the doctor sent that tissue off. They put it on a slide. And then a human being had to look at a very, very large number of cells, 100,000 or so, to see which of those cells was actually potentially malignant. And then goes back to the doc. Well, that takes a long time. Well, analytic has software that looks at that same batch of cells and says, you know, 998,000 of these are okay, but these 50, you better look at. And so what it does is takes that very large set of choices and reduces them to a meaningful set that a human being has to make a judgment about. It's human augmentation, not human replacement. Where the judgment actually makes the difference is on those 50 cells that the machine cannot make the judgment. And we're going to see many, many more examples of that combined intelligence of human beings exercising certain unique qualities and machines doing those things that they do particularly well. So I'm going to spend a fair amount of time on what does all that really mean. So what we're seeing now is this notion of intelligence augmentation. So that little computer screen you see there is an application that is already being used in the insurance industry by State Farm in an experimental way. So guy takes a picture, the insurance adjuster, you've had an accident, takes a picture of your smashed up right fender. And what happens then? Well, normally what would happen is he'd fill out some forms, take the pictures, make some phone calls, find the local body shop, come up with some estimates, etc. All of that might take a few hours, might take a few days before your car actually gets attended to. Now, with this new application, takes a picture, the AI looks at it, immediately makes a recommendation on the cost, immediately connects with a bunch of local body shops, gets you an appointment. The whole thing takes about 30 seconds. 30 seconds from the time the insurance adjuster takes the picture to the time you can begin to roll to where your car is going to be taken to be repaired. little bit of AI in that process. The picture of the nurse there. This is also an experimental system being used by a number of hospitals. It's a nurse in an emergency room where they have to make real-time, high-speed choices about assignments of patients, of capacity, et cetera, in a variety of situations. Well, there's a lot of information that a head nurse has to absorb at that moment and make the rapid decisions. Now there's an AI that gives her information in real time on who's available, what spaces are available, what technology is available, which operating rooms are available, et cetera, and makes recommendations to her as she's looking at a screen on who to move, which patients to move, which doctors to call in, and so on in real time, improving her performance, improving the efficiency of operations of the emergency room. Down on your lower left. As I mentioned, I'm part of a cancer research company. In the old days, basically what you did is you came up with a hypothesis for a molecule that you then tried to figure out what kind of, say, cancer receptor it might fit to. Well, there's an awful lot of molecules. I mean, a very large number of very complex molecules. The new model is actually you run a whole bunch of models, a whole bunch of molecules, and the computer itself is testing those molecules and then forming a hypothesis of which kind of molecules might actually be worth testing. And so it's basically helping you form hypotheses. It isn't, again, replacing the scientist, but improving the yield and productivity of scientific research. And that is how we operate at UCSF, doing, in fact, cancer research already. And then the lower right is really about avoiding bias in hiring. We all have unconscious biases, but it is possible to construct an interview instrument for an interviewer, actually enabling them to actually carry out an interview, sensing their own biases, and then actually improving the quality of the interview to take out the unconscious bias that all of us have. And that already exists in an experimental form. All of these involve bits of intelligence to improve the quality of human judgment and human capability rather than to replace them. And I think this is a very, very important phenomenon. Because as you know, there's an enormous amount of anxiety about whether we're going to replace people with, machines. And I think, you know, when you start thinking about the future of AI, there's been a lot of hype recently from people like Elon Musk, Stephen Hawking, Bill Gates, about are the AIs going to take over, right? And they don't need us anymore. Well, I think that's a long way off. And in fact, they have actually just now created something called the Partnership on AI to Benefit People in Society. But think about this, to really build a real AI requires a deep understanding of human intelligence, of the brain. And we're a long, long way from that. The brain is probably today the most complex machine in the universe. And I mean that literally, in the universe. And we've just launched, in fact, last 2 weeks ago, I was on a conference call with the White House on the next generation planning for the Brain Initiative in the United States. We have a 30-year Brain Initiative that we've launched here in the U.S. Europe has its own equivalent. The first 10 years of that initiative are understanding a mouse brain. We're mapping the neurons of a mouse brain. That's going to take 10 years. As far as I know, only Donald Trump has a mouse brain. No offense, I hope. I'm worried. Like you, Governor Romer, I'm worried. And having said that, human brain is at least another 20 years behind that. So we've got many decades before we understand the brain well enough to even think about trying to map it onto silicon. So worrying about AIs taking over, that's bad science fiction. We don't have to worry, you know. And something that was not mentioned, I actually write science fiction movies. My first film was a film called War Games, which some of you may have seen as a kid, and we had a computer there that actually had machine learning. You don't need to worry about that. And Terminator, you don't need to worry about that. All that kind of stuff, bad science fiction. My last film was a film called Minority Report, which actually showed some of the technologies that we're showing, talking about now. I thought it might take a bit longer, but we're moving even faster than we did in Minority Report. So now let's actually start focusing on what does this mean for work, for how business is going to work, and what that means for education. Well, first of all, what we're seeing is a dramatic change in how business actually works. Salesforce is an example of the kind of the next economy companies. You create platforms that enable networks to operate on those platforms. You augment workers rather than just replace them, so you're making them more capable with intelligence. You're creating amazing user experiences. That's what Facebook and Google and Amazon have done. You're really redesigning technology to redesign the way services ought to work. One click on Amazon is brilliant. I mean, I don't know how many of you use OneClick, but it's, you know, right in the background, little bit of intelligence, figures out it's me, completes that transaction in a nanosecond, right? OneClick. It transforms the structure of an industry, right? Information, book publishing, all of that changed. And it depends upon a rich ecosystem. So this is what companies of the future actually begin to look like. And you start thinking about how those ecosystems work. I had an amazing experience with my Apple Watch. Salesforce gave me this watch for something I did. And my wife and I were going to go see The Martian, because I was going to interview the author on stage, and she had never seen the movie. So I said, you got to see the movie if you're going to come with me. How many of you saw The Martian, by the way? Like the best science movie ever, right? As I mentioned, I'm an astronautical engineer. I wanted to be, you know, the guy on Mars, absolutely the coolest film. So I went online that morning to order my movie tickets on my laptop. I ordered the movie tickets for the AMC in Emeryville, and I didn't think about it. And about 45 minutes before the movie, my watch buzzed. And up came a sentence on my watch, and it said, Peter, you need to leave for the movies in 10 minutes, and there's no traffic between you and the theater. Well, I didn't do anything. I didn't configure any software. I didn't organize anything. But my laptop read my email, found I was going to the movies, sent a message to my iPhone that then checked Google Maps. The ecosystem was at work, checking where the theater was, further elements of the ecosystem, found out what time it was playing, sent a message back to my iPhone that then figured out that the best place to inform me was, in fact, my watch, and then formed a perfect English sentence to inform me that I needed to leave in 10 minutes. That's little AI. That's what I mean by a little bit of intelligence embedded everywhere. So that's what we're going to see is not big AI, human brain substitute, but little AI that gets embedded in every device, in every context, and provides that kind of service so you don't have to think about it. So, we're going to, in manufacturing, revolutionize supply chains. We're going to use things like 3D printing to manufacture things almost everywhere. Outside of Louisville, there's a company called Radius, Fast Radius, that already has 100 3D printers at work, supervised by one person, that you call up, you need a spare part, they make it instantaneously and ship it out on UPS. Now you start thinking about what that supply chain may look like. A new company just was launched about 2 weeks ago called Feetz, F-E-E-T-Z. Feetz is 3D printing of shoes, right? I don't know about you gentlemen, but I have about 10 pairs of shoes. My wife has the Imelda Marcos Memorial Wall of Shoes. Half the shopping malls of the world, all the stores are women's shoe stores. Imagine, and a good friend of mine, a woman named Ping Fu, who made one of the most advanced 3D printers, came to my house recently, and she was wearing a pair of shoes she had printed that morning. You scan your foot, perfect fit, the shoes are ready in a few minutes, and they cost next to nothing. Now you think about the world supply chain of food, of shoes, right? Now imagine if we were making all those shoes one-off on the spot. Now, I don't think we're actually going to do that, but you start rethinking how business works when you start rethinking that kind of a supply chain when it begins to look rather different. This is House, the website for remodeling. How many of you have used House? Right. Mike, what were you remodeling? So a little sewing room turned an old bedroom into a sewing room. Yeah, we did our bathroom and a bedroom recently. So what is this? This is a quite remarkable platform, because all House did was create a platform where people who had done cool projects, their bedroom, their bathroom, their sewing room, a new garage, whatever it may, upload their projects. One of the things that Facebook taught us is people like to share a lot more than we thought, so they upload their projects, and including the contractors who did it and the products that they used. It creates a marketplace. All House did was create the platform. 100% of the content is generated by the users on both sides of that. There are literally millions and millions of projects here now, and there are many more platforms coming like it. The one up on the right, Menagerie, is for wedding planning. Right? Another place where you want to learn what was the cool dress somebody wore, what were the centerpieces for the tables, et cetera, et cetera. So now there's one called Menagerie for wedding planning. So there's a great variety of these coming along, new kinds of platforms. The music business. was transformed by this technology. You remember when we used to buy LPs, right? About 12 bucks an LP with 12 songs on it, right? Then came the CD, and then came the MP3, and we started downloading music. And that changed everything, because we weren't buying albums anymore, we were buying songs. And that blue line is album sales in terms of dollars. So what did musicians have to do? They had to go on tour. And last year, we sponsored the U2 tour, the biggest tour in the world last year. But essentially now they depend upon tour revenue. And so the game has changed fundamentally in the structure of the music industry as well. So where this is taking us is the beginning of a transformation in the workforce itself, is how dramatic the change in independent workers is. And the number that I find quite striking is if you look at that pie chart there, a third of people over 52 have worked as part-time workers already. So it's not just kids who are doing it, it is also across the age spectrum. And it's quite dramatic in its implications. Part of what's going on here is a fundamental new business model. There are, in business, people need to be far more competitive, far more flexible in what they do. Workers are much less committed to individual companies. They move around a lot. But we also now have new platforms that enable those people to connect. So there are people with excess capacity of stuff they have and people who want to use them, and now we can connect their platform. So you got a car and somebody would like a ride, you have Uber. You've got a bedroom and somebody would like to sleep, you have Airbnb. And there are many more like that. Pokewalk, right? You all know what Pokewalk is? No. Right? You remember the Pokemon Go phenomenon a few weeks ago, which was the first example of augmented reality, right? I have a 26-year-old Pokemon hunter. My son. It turns out there were Pokemon living on our terrace, I guess. But having said that, Pokewalk is if you're too busy to actually go capture your own Pokemon, these guys will take your smartphone out and capture them for you. right? Pokewalk. But we're working, for example, with Coke Germany that has warehouses, they have bottling facilities, they have delivery trucks, they have local distribution points that are not 100% utilized. Now they can open up access to those assets using a platform that we've built for them that can have people who want to have stuff bottled, drinks, water, beer in their facilities, stuff on their trucks, stuff in their warehouses, and so on, to actually increase the utilization of their assets. And so what we're going to see is the technology improve utilization of a great variety of assets as well. But the peer economy is what this is all about. And I highly recommend Robin Chase's book, Peers, Inc., which really gets into this in some depth. Another key element of this is crowdsourcing. So we have people being able to participate in a great variety of ways. We have all these different forms of crowdsourcing, whether it's citizens engagement, equity-based crowdfunding. My son has a Kickstarter going right now for a big live-action role-playing game that he's going to do. He has it up on Kickstarter. GWIN is General Mills' Worldwide Innovation Network, General Foods, pardon me. And it's a cereal network. For all those cereal eaters out there who would say, gee, wouldn't it be cool if I combined my Cheerios with my soy bars? Okay, let's try it. So up go the suggestions, and they're crowdsourced, and they try stuff. You want some experts? Hourly Nerd will do that in a crowdsourced way. Down below, that's the first crowdsourced 3D printed car from Local Motors. Today you can go to their website and order a car for $53,000. They will print it for you, and all the components will be crowdsourced, the drivetrain, the brakes, the steering system, all of that. But the one I particularly love is the one in the lower right there in Italy. Recently, there was a major earthquake, you may remember, in Italy, and what they did to help in the rescue effort is they crowdsourced the identification of the missing. And so they provided high-resolution satellite and aircraft imagery on the web, and people took a square meter and examined that in great depth. They would blow it up and looking for a wounded hand under a piece of rubble, etc. And this is how they found literally hundreds of missing people using crowdsourcing of the search process. So crowdsourcing represents another kind of business model. But as we said, we're really worried about what all of this implies for jobs. So let me just read this, because I think it's a very important statement from Time magazine. Not just the number of jobs lost to more efficient machines, but automation may prevent the economy from creating enough new jobs. Automation is beginning to move in and eliminate the service and office jobs, too. I mean, I think we must be doomed. Oh, wait a minute. This was 1961. This was three waves of automation ago. I assume you're all unemployed, right? All you office workers and stuff like that and service jobs, right? You're all unemployed, huh? We didn't create any of your jobs. We are now in the fifth wave of this concern. We've gone through these technological transformations, and every single time we have created more jobs than we've destroyed. We've improved the jobs, not eliminated them. And this chart gives you a very important piece of data. This is the percentage of the population in work in the ages roughly 25 to 54 plus, the working age population. In 1950, with a population of 160 million people, it was about 60%. In 2015, with a population of 350 million, it's closer to 70%, closer to 80%, pardon me. In other words, vastly many more workers in a much larger economy than in 1950. And you see some glitches, bubbles along the way. There, you can see the several recessions and so on. But in that wave, there were four major technological transformations we went through, and you can't see them in the job participation rates there. Now, a big hunk of this was women going to work, right? 1950, the female participation rate was much lower than the male. So what we did see was male jobs shifting to female jobs. And that was a big transformation. But the important point is that we keep creating more jobs. You think about industries that didn't exist. This place. You look around this place, and all the jobs necessary to make this happen, that got you here, that rented you the cars, that flew you here, that ran the airport, that operate these ski lifts, all of that, none of that existed 50 years ago. Life was simpler, cheaper, and most people were poor, and a few people were wealthy. Today, vast numbers of people are relatively well off, and they're coming skiing, and they're buying skis, and they're learning how to ski, and they're doing all kinds of things that they never did before. We create whole entirely new industries. Now, are there big issues along the way? Absolutely. And you are the answer to the issues, because the question is, can they meet the skills necessary for each of these waves of jobs? And that's the core crucial issue. It isn't that the jobs won't be there. The jobs will be there. The question is, will the population be suited to the jobs that we need to fill? And that's the really hard issue. Because you start looking at what are the jobs that are actually going to be there, and you start thinking about the different categories of activities that people have to fill, right? And the blue areas over there to your right, those are the things that are fairly susceptible to essentially easy replacement, predictable mechanical work, assembly line stuff, for example, collecting data, processing data. At the other end, things that are very hard, managing people. It'd be a long time before robots could be managers, right? Making good judgment. I showed you how you can improve the quality of judgment. One of the ones I love is unpredictable physical work. The plumber. Imagine, I don't know what your kitchen sink is like underneath your kitchen sink, but imagine a plumber who wants to come and fix the plumbing under my kitchen sink. Well, he's got to figure out his, you know, these, what are this bottle, what are these sponges, what's it, can I move this? No robot can do that today, and it's going to be a long time. There's going to be a lot of those kinds of tasks. Construction tasks, very difficult for machines to do. A machine could help a construction worker, but a long time before it can replace a construction worker. So there's a whole set of categories of work that are not very vulnerable and a whole set of categories that are. Now, things will affect how that actually happens. Is it actually feasible to do it? Is it worth doing in terms of costs? What's the supply and demand of labor? What's cheap? What's expensive? And of course, there are regulatory issues and questions of social choice, et cetera. So it won't all happen in a kind of coherent, single great swoop. There'll be a lot of experimentation and changes along the way. So you start unpacking all of that, and there are things that machines do particularly well. Frequent high volume tasks, right? Things like that. Machine consistency. On the other hand, machines are very bad at abstract tasks. You know, seeing total patterns, et cetera, manual tasks that require kind of little bits of judgment. And important thing is machines only learn from the past, right? Machine learning depends upon the history of data. An entirely new category of task simply doesn't fit, can't be done because there's no data to actually demonstrate it. The machine can't learn on the basis of that data. So novel tasks don't lend it. So there's going to be still a whole lot of things that actually still require human skills, human abilities to carry out. Now, we start thinking about education, all right? So, as I said, I'm 70. I had to learn I started at Salesforce when I was 65. And I had to learn a whole new industry, OK? I can tell you that the tools I had for trying to learn the software industry were not very good. I went out and bought some books and so on. I took some of our own classes, but they were pretty funky, to be honest. Well, an interesting thing is happening. Everybody's expecting my generation to retire. Forget it. We're not going to retire. For two reasons. We don't want to, and we can't. That we don't want to is we're still young, vigorous, healthy, motivated to do stuff. You know, I'd be bored silly if I didn't do this job and if I'd retired. You know, I love tennis and I love reading, but I can only do so much tennis and so much reading. I like making a difference in the world. Governor Romer, 88, you said, right? Sounds like you're pretty active still. And it looks like your family around you is pretty active as well. So the point is that we're not going to see this huge wave of baby boom retirement. For one, they don't want to. And secondly, their 401ks are now 201ks. And they can't afford to retire. You look at the numbers of their ability to support retirement, particularly because they're going to live a long time, right? They're not going to die at age 80, 85. 88, 90, 90, we're going to see a lot of centenarians. So they need money, they're going to work a long time, but what that means is they're going to have to be retrained and educated. So there's this huge emerging market of my generation that is going to be doing new stuff, that want to learn new stuff, some for entertainment purposes, like I take tennis lessons and I want to make my tennis game a whole lot better. My game has never been better, but I had to learn a whole new industry. And we're going to see lots of that happening. You look in medicine, and you see what doctors are going to have to learn by way of new techniques, right? We were talking about that over breakfast. You see the radical transformation of happening in medicine. So we are moving to this era where there's a whole new education market developing of the over 55s. And I'm a good example of that. We also have a new model of the relationship between the individual and the company with respect to learning. Reid Hoffman wrote a terrific book called The Alliance, which you haven't seen, makes the argument that in this era where workers don't tend to have lifelong careers, they move. So how do you get their loyalty? Well, you get their loyalty by investing in them, by educating and improving their skills. The deal is you come to work at Salesforce, you work there 4, 5, 6 years, you go off to a startup. When you leave, you better have more skills and more capability than when you came. That's the deal we offer you. Meanwhile, we want your loyalty and commitment to do what we need to have done. And that new model is beginning to emerge across industry, this kind of mutual commitment. I invest in you and you commit to me. And I love this quote from Alvin Toffler, one of my mentors, as it were. The illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. And it's that process that I think is really quite central to where we're going. And we, you know, none of you are up here already in terms of new technologies for learning. Salesforce has invested in substantially. This is our platform, we call it Trailhead, for learning for our customers, because one of the things we've learned is our products become more complex. We have to invest much more in the learning of our customers. So where are we going? This is where I want to wrap it up, is this notion of a general platform economy, where we see essentially a great variety of platforms for learning in action. And you'll see a new generation of workers put together in new ways, evolving new skills, diverse ways of participating, new opportunities to play. And what it is particularly well suited is for this gig economy, great variety of ways of participating in it, whether you're entrepreneurs, whether you're freelancers, whether you're a worker coming back into the workforce and so on. And so we're seeing, you know, rather than the traditional old model, you get a job when you're 23, 24, and you stick with it. People are moving, changing roles over the course of their lives, changing industries and sets of skills. So how do you create essentially a learning model for that? Where I want to end up with is a short video that was prepared by the Institute for the Future on learning as earning. And it builds on the blockchain technology and shows a completely new model for thinking about the relationship of work and learning. Could you roll the video, please?
Your Ledger account tracks everything you've ever learned in units called EduBlocks. Each EduBlock represents 1 hour of learning in a particular subject. Anyone can grant EduBlocks to anyone else. you can earn EduBlocks from a formal institution like a school or your workplace. But you can also earn them from individuals or informal groups like a community center or an app. The Ledger makes it possible for you to get credit for learning that happens anywhere, even when you're just doing the things you love. Your profile displays all the EduBlocks you've earned. Employers can use this information to offer you a job or a gig that matches your skills. We'll keep track of all the income your skills generate and use that data to provide feedback on your courses. When choosing a subject to study in the future, you may wish to choose the subject whose students are earning the most income. You can also use the Ledger to find investors in your education. Since the Ledger is already tracking income earned from each EduBlock, you can offer investors a percentage of your future income in exchange for free learning hours. Our smart contracts make these agreements easy to manage and administer. The Ledger is built on blockchain, the same technology that powers Bitcoin and other digital currencies. That means every EduBlock that has ever been earned is a permanent part of the growing public record of our collective learning and working.
Always learning, always earning, that's my motto. I try to learn something new every month, but it ain't easy. I'm a freelance delivery driver, so my schedule isn't steady. One thing that helps, I love to read. So I listen to a lot of audiobooks when I'm driving. Memoirs, history, philosophy. Oh, and I got that app that gives you blocks whenever you finish a book. I'm part of a learning group, a bunch of other drivers I met on a forum. We all take turns teaching the group. Sometimes we add blocks to our profiles, but it isn't really about that. It's more like Ledger has opened up people's eyes to the fact that teachers are everywhere.
I started teaching last summer right after the federal government announced the Pay It Forward program. You know about that, right? If you have federal student loans from college, you can pay them down by teaching someone else what you learned. Whatever blocks you earned in school, you can teach them to others. The University of Texas, that's where I did my degree, they report all my college credits directly into the Ledger, so I'm pre-approved to teach any subject I passed. Like virtual reality programming. If I can teach someone that course, I get $2,500 off my debt. I use the same textbook that I used in college, and I Skype with them 3 times a week to answer questions and help them with their coding assignments.
Sooner or later, most people find themselves at a point in their learning where they need to make a decision. Do you go for the traditional college degree or build your own higher education? That's the kind of tough choice that a lot of young people are facing right now.
Yes, I won!
This is Texas Fold'em. It's one of those protein folding simulators where you learn how proteins work inside the human body. And you can help solve puzzles for science. Every time you solve a puzzle, you earn this biochemistry EduBlock. And the better you get at it, the harder the puzzles get. Well, I guess I got pretty good at protein folding, because one day, this trophy showed up, and they started giving me super hard puzzles working on these mind-blowing structures that even the real scientists haven't figured out yet. But wait a minute. I'm one of the real scientists now, actually, because I'm not just earning EduBlocks now, they're also paying me for every puzzle I solve. This game is sort of like my first class in biochemistry, and it's also my first job.
We used to have this concept of entry-level jobs. You would start with a company, and then you could move your way up. That's how I started here. We hardly have any full-time jobs here. We mostly hire on a project basis. We check their ledgers, and if their credentials match our needs, then we'll put them in the hiring pool. Of course, relationships are still important, and we still help people grow. They're earning EduBlocks with every hour of work they put in.
Why give someone a generic test when you can actually evaluate their work in a real-world context? When you log into a verification site, it gives you a task, a chance to demonstrate your proficiency in a real-world context. You can write some copy, translate some text, design a logo, grade an essay. This is actually how most pay it forward verification works these days, and pretty much any credentialing that you do on informal learning. You're even paid for your time. Not the going rate, more like minimum wage. When did anyone ever get paid for taking a final exam?
Every project we hire for, we don't just list the monetary compensation. We also list exactly how many EduBlocks in which skill areas we'll grant you. That way, your work here counts as learning for your next gig.
When it's my turn to teach, I take it really seriously. Because for me, learning has always been the one thing that's connected everything else in my life. Where I've been, where I'm going, I may not know where that is yet, but I know I won't be a driver forever. And when I get there, I know I'll still be learning.
So I thought that was a pretty interesting example of a really radical reimagining of what both work and education might be like. Now, we already have one example of an industry that actually is organized this way, and it's the film industry. If you look at how Hollywood is organized with the film studios and the craft skills and the actors and the directors and everything in the infrastructure to support that, what you have, is, as I said, is I help write movies. No writer works for a studio. You actually end up working on a project basis. No director works for a studio. They work on a project basis and so on. And so we have a model of an industry that has already been organized this way, and you can begin to see how many more industries will be organized this way. So to put it all together, could I have the last slide back up? There we go. What I see happening is technology being embedded everywhere, intelligence being embedded everywhere, the ability to speak to your environment supporting you, and that kind of constant learning process and engagement with being able to relearn and re-educate in a rather rapidly changing technological environment is probably the most important skill that we can have as an individual. And you all are the key to our future. Without you, there will be no good future here. And if you all succeed, we will all have a far better future. Thank you very much.